Where's the informant?
Oh, here he comes.
Judas! Judas! Oh, over here!
Hey, guys. Glad you can make it. Have you got the place surrounded?
Yeah. There's no way they can escape.
What did those guys do anyway?
Oh, you know, it's a typical end-of-the-world messiah cult stuff, you know.
Again? That's like the 100th one this month.
Okay, so which one is the ringleader? His name is Jeebus, right?
I believe it's Jesus. And yeah, he does like most of the normal parlor tricks. He turns water into wine. Wait, you guys don't know who he is?
Well, how would I know? They all smell like fish and they have hippie hair.
But he kicked out the moneylenders out of the temple. He fed a whole bunch of people with just a couple fish. He draws crowds everywhere. I mean, he raised a dude from the...
Yeah, whatever. I think we would have noticed that.
Yeah, whatever. Let's get him. Let's get him. Okay, let's go.
Okay. I'll go. And whoever you see me kiss, that's your guy.
What? Kiss him? What? Could you just, like, point to the guy?
Wait, is that lip balm?
Hey, look, I don't tell you guys how to do your job.
Hey, Jesus. Lay one on me, baby.
Freaking Colts.
Oh, yeah. Hey, this is Dave Fitzgerald, and I took a left at the valley.
I know we shouldn't have to scream that we're atheists. You know, we don't have non-astrologers and all that. But with religious people taking over the world, I mean, we can either speak up or be pushed into a corner.
I'm proud of being an atheist, a skeptic, a non-believer, an infidel, a heathen. I call it how I see it. I say it's ignorance and you just call it faith. And unsubstantiated claims, that's something to be ashamed. I'm an atheist.
Coming at you from Secret Lair BC, this is Left of the Valley 2.0. My name is Kevin, and I just saw some red-breasted birds selling ice cream. I think they were Baskin-Robbins. Joining me as usual is a team that will tell you that never blame someone else for the road you're on. That's their own asphalt. She accidentally said big instead of grande at Starbucks, so they shot her. Your leg's alright?
Yeah, it's fine.
And he got fired from cleaning his own home because he was caught drinking on the job by his wife, Brent Lee.
That's far too close to
that's true. That's a true story. That actually.
Guys, welcome back.
Thanks for having us.
Happy Easter, I guess, I should say.
No, I'm still going with whatever Brent said, the murder blood cult day.
Murder blood cult day, thank you.
Yeah, let's go with that.
Murder blood cult day.
And today we'll have our old friend Dr. Darryl Ray will come on the show to talk about human sexuality, but first let's do a bit of chat. But even first, before that, we have a friend. We have Darryl from Saskatchewan. Darryl, how you doing, man?
I'm just fine. Two Darryls on the show. This is going to make it interesting. My other brother, Darryl.
That's right. A brother from another mother.
Yeah. The essence of a true dad joke is that it's never original. It always makes you roll your eyes.
Yeah, we don't do dad jokes on the show at all.
Never.
Yeah.
Never.
Great, 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 great granddad.
Darryl, you're a friend of
yeah.
Darryl, you're a friend of the show, and your listeners, so we're happy to have you with us. But how about you tell us a bit about yourself? Tell us about, you don't have to be super specific about where you are and all that if you don't want to, but, you know, tell us a bit about maybe your apostasy or something like that.
Yeah, I don't know. It's a long story, and I can go all over the place with it. I'm in Eastern Saskatchewan.
Well, we don't have time for that now, so thank you for coming.
Yeah. You threatened me with 2 hours. I'm not going to fill it up. Still dealing with a bit of snow and puddles here.
No way.
Okay, apostasy. I grew up Mennonite, not all the way full fundamentalist, but I like saying Amish light. It hasn't caught on well, but that's basically what it is. Ew. Went to a small church school, finished at grade 9, never went to high school, but we do have cars, or had cars and electricity and stuff, so not fully off the grid like Amish are. And I I don't know if I ever fully bought into religion, but I played the game for a long time.
Don't really have a choice.
I didn't have a choice. Played the game for a long time, but what I did buy into was life is better when you're in a simple life. Like, life is better when you follow the religious rules and all of that. That's what I was convinced of, and everybody outside of religion is living a hard life, and their life is so hard, and they're all bad people and everything.
That's very interesting that you say that, because I think that's really akin to a lot of people like to say the return to nature, and you know, they'll buy natural products, and they say you know, they like to simplify their life, and that's a very attractive message.
Absolutely.
It is an attractive message, and what finally got me to admit I was an atheist and admit that I grew up in a cult was getting to know, making friends with people who were not part of the cult, who were good people and happy people.
You're not supposed to do that. That's why.
Exactly.
Don't you know we're all
you're only allowed to talk to them if you're converting them.
Yeah. Don't you know we're all eating atheists?
They are very, very upfront. That's why they have their own school. They don't want their kids to be talking to too many other people before they're fully indoctrinated.
Yeah. Did you grow up in rural Saskatchewan?
Yeah. Oh, okay. I moved here from Abbotsford when I was...
You moved from Abbotsford?
Six. Yeah, okay.
Yep, Abbotsford is home for me.
Well, that's
kind of the Bible Belt of BC, so that kind of makes sense.
That's kind of interesting, because Abbotsford is essentially where we started. Left the valley started, so isn't that interesting?
Oh, well, I was just about to ask. I was like, because I'm not familiar with Sasquatch.
Well, we're not familiar. Abbotsford's in BC, Brent, not DC, BC.
Okay, so another word I'm trying to get going. Someone from Saskatchewan, Saskatchewanian is very hard to say. We should all be referred to as Sasquatches.
I love it, Sasquatches.
That's good.
I know in Alberta they've got like a Catholic school system, and kids actually go through that. Is that the same in Saskatchewan, where there's an actual school system was it private school? The in Alberta, the Catholic school system's like public school.
Yeah, and so is BC actually.
It's not the same.
It's actually we've done this show on the show before. The Alberta school is actually the religious school, but it's still 100% funded by the government. Here in BC, it's 50%.
Wow.
Oh, yeah, okay. But it's still, there's something about it. Anyway, at the holiday, anyway, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, we're going on a tangent.
Yeah, let's not. Let's not take a left at this valley. We'll go right again.
U-turn, guys.
Well, back on track.
Well, thank you so much, Darryl, and thanks for being with us, and we're glad to have you on the show today. So let's do a bit of chit-chat, guys. Did you guys hear some of the news here? Speaking of, might as well stay in BC. In October 2018, BC in British Columbia adopted SOGI. SOGI is essentially sexual orientation, gender identity into schools. So how do schools will become more friendly towards the LGBTQ community? Despite a lot of pressure from religious groups, this Saturday, April the 10th, at the Vancouver Art Gallery, that's a very big spot in Vancouver where they have a lot of protests most of the time. There's an anti-trans protest taking place.
They tried so hard. The city of Vancouver did not want this protest at all.
What is it with religious people that just get so enamored with the fucking, you know, being against trans folks? Like, that just blows their whole fucking mind.
They need an enemy, right? They need an enemy. I mean, the gays were for the longest time, but now that, you know, being gay is accepted, they have to focus on something else, right?
And it's a constant movement. It was interracial marriages. Now it's trans. And I wonder what it's going to be next.
Man.
But it's true. If you look at the history of Christianity, especially, it's like, you know, left-handed people, and then it was like blacks, and then it was interracial marriage, and then it's like gays.
And you know, interracial marriage, it wasn't that long ago. When I was a teen, it was still kind of looked down upon.
So, of course, there's going to be a lot of weirdos speaking there, and apparently also Barry Neufeld. We spoke about Barry Neufeld in the past. He's a school trustee in the city of Chilliwack near Abbotsford. He's going to be there. He's a very vocal anti-trans person.
Can we go down there?
We probably could.
Let's go down there and start chanting.
The city of Vancouver trying to basically say, you know, they support the trans community, but they cannot stop the protest because it's a question of, you know, freedom of speech.
Yep.
Unfortunately, for a lot of people, you know, they, I remember speaking to some of these people at the, these this particular group, and this is years ago, where they were trying to make me swallow things like, for example, that the College of Pediatricians is on their side. Now, when you hear stuff like the College of Pediatricians, it sounds, you know, it sounds pretty official, right?
Right.
But the College of Pediatricians is actually a hate group. It's not the real thing. The real thing is called, I think it's the Association of Pediatricians of America or something like that.
Yeah, it's meant to sound like it to confuse people.
Exactly.
That's why they cite it.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. So that's pretty bad. Okay, moving on to something better. Did you guys find, some researchers found an ancient piece of chewing gum. It's not chewing gum, but it's actually birch pitch in Denmark. And it's, that's what they used to chew on back then, right? And they extracted the DNA material from it, and it revealed that it was chewed by a woman that they nicknamed Lola about 5,700 years ago. She had blue eyes, dark skin, and hair, and she also had the Epstein-Darrel virus, which apparently infects 90% of adults. The DNA was also, they also extracted DNA from the hazelnuts in that chewing pitch there, and mallards, so her, one of her last meals when she was chewing that was essentially duck with some nuts, right? So her DNA didn't match the more agricultural societies at the area in Denmark at the time, so she could have been a part of a hunter-gathering tribe still 5,700 years ago.
Like a nomadic tribe that kind of moves?
Yes. Okay. And this is fairly recent in history. It also says the funny thing is the skin, the, her light, it also shows that because she had dark skin, that the whole Caucasian thing, so it supports that the Caucasian color, if you wish, is fairly recent.
Hmm. Wait, hold on. So, is chewing gum just a fundamental part of human DNA?
No.
That's kind of weird.
No.
It's the fact that we need something to chew on. So what we were chewing on, you know, 700 years ago was actually chewing gum.
We all had these bad habits even way back.
But chewing is also a thing that kind of helps actually clean your teeth, right?
Yeah, that's true.
When you chew it on something.
Yeah, pulls it out, especially if you've got the cavities,
Yeah, exactly. So it helps kind of extract and then the rubbing and all that of the on your teeth kind of helps clean them. So that's very interesting to find that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and last but not least, a Michigan Catholic church, they had an antique crucifix, and it was reduced to rubble. And the villain in the story is they found a rampaging squirrel.
Even squirrels are atheists.
So this is St. Anne Church. The staff in the church was they were confronted by a sand squirrel sitting on the piano when they walked in. The plants were tipped over, the candles were knocked down, and Jesus was missing both his head and both arms.
I love it.
Satanic squirrel took a bite out of Jesus, apparently. So an engineer took Jesus home and replastered him. And then the church commented by saying, "Don't try to destroy Jesus. He will win every time." Oh, Jesus' lengthy battle against squirrels. What can I say?
Love it.
I knew they were evil. I knew it.
Yep. Yeah, squirrels.
Did you guys ever hear that? There's an old joke that basically said there was a rabbi and an imam that went to this Catholic priest, and they said, you know, Father, you know, in our city we have infestation of squirrels, and they're all over the place. But we see at your church, your church doesn't seem affected by them. What's your secret? And the Catholic priest told him, that's quite simple. I just baptized him. I made him into the Catholic, so they just show up at Easter and Christmas now.
That's perfect.
Oh, that's great. All right, moving on. Well, we don't have a top 10 this week, but that's okay because it is, you know, Easter, and Easter mm-hmm. is that magical holiday when Jesus rises from the grave, and if he sees his shadow, there's 6 more weeks of winter.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
But I do have some nice Easter facts. So this might be interesting for you guys to hear. Did you guys know that for this year, for 2021, they expect $21.6 billion is going to be spent on Easter. $21.6 billion.
Just chocolate?
Nope, that's the whole spending total.
Oh, okay.
$3 billion of that is spending on candy. So $3 billion worth of candy for Easter.
Sounds about right. That's my budget.
Yeah. The most expensive bunny, Easter bunny, is actually $49,000. Yeah, and he weighs about 500.
Is it a real bunny? Is it a real bunny that delivers actual eggs? Come on.
That he can lay eggs. I mean, if he lays eggs, makes perfect sense.
At that price, you might as well have that.
Right? Where is he made?
It doesn't say, unfortunately. Oh. Did you know that 78% of the people eat the bunny ears first?
Absolutely, I did know that.
11% eat the feet first, and 11% eat the tail first.
I just don't
eat them. This study? And why?
There's facts. I do some crazy fun studies.
Apparently, $180 is the average per person that they're spending on celebrating Easter.
I guess like his buying groceries for dinner.
Yeah,
stuff
like that.
Okay.
Apparently, $3.6 billion is actually spent on clothing for Easter. I had no idea this was a thing.
Oh, yeah. There's so many videos of my mom and her Easter specials.
No, really?
Oh, yeah.
Easter clothing? Is that a thing for you guys, too?
We always got dressed up, you know, for Easter and everything growing up, but
I didn't get
a shirt that had little bunnies on it or anything.
We wore really special dresses and we had really nice hats with ribbons and we would get little white gloves and shiny Mary Jane shoes and new leotards. Loved Easter.
The $6.3 billion is actually spent on food for Easter. So it's a big thing, too, as well.
That makes sense.
There's 91 million bunnies sold in the U.S. for Easter.
Real bunnies or chocolate bunnies?
Well, chocolate bunnies.
91 million?
91 million.
That's not even one per person.
Well, I don't know.
What are you guys doing down there? I would have believed you said Canada. Okay.
Is there 16 billion jelly beans consumed? Apparently, jelly beans are a thing for Easter too. I never grew up with that, so I don't know.
One year, I used them as rabbit poop, and I told my daughter that the rabbit pooped his way through the house, and she had to follow his poop to find where he hid all her eggs.
Oh God!
Just black jelly beans or multicolored ones?
No, they were multicolor. He's the bunny rabbit, man.
To give you an idea, 16 billion jelly beans would actually circle the Earth 3 times.
Inconceivable!
That's insane. That's an
unsanitary tradition right there. That's just...
She didn't eat the jelly beans. They were poop.
Going on, 81% of parents actually admit stealing candy from the kid's stash.
100%. How many percent said that? Because
the other 81%.
Oh, the other 19% are lying. That's like parent tax.
The largest chocolate egg ever done weighed 15,873 pounds.
That's crazy.
Now, to give you an idea, 16,000 pounds is the weight of an elephant. So, this egg was as heavy as an elephant.
Well, 15,000 pounds, that's like 8 tons. Almost.
No, not quite.
Yeah. Almost. Seven. Yeah, right?
Yeah, more like 6, but anyway.
No, isn't 2,000 pounds a
It's
ton?
2.2.
Oh, never mind.
Did they do
I'm
it
wrong,
just to get in the Book of Records? Like the
most likely.
Probably, yeah.
Most likely. The largest chocolate bunny weighed 9,360 pounds.
Wow.
Where do they keep
them? I wonder how long it takes to eat
them?
That.
They don't keep them very long. It melts.
You're going to have a roach problem in that house.
And not the fun kind of roaches either.
No, exactly. Marshmallow Peeps. That's an American tradition.
Yes, and I've heard of them, and they look gross.
They are awful. There is apparently 23 flavors of Marshmallow Peep.
Really? Have you ever had those, Brent?
Yeah, actually, it's funny, too. I can't stand them, but you know who's going to get really upset by all of our comments on this?
Mm-hmm.
Is Amy with a Y. She fucking loves Peeps.
Good. Good.
Okay, so that explains why you guys hate them so much.
Perfect. We don't like them.
Oh, God.
Peeps for losers. But did you know that 5.5 million peeps are produced every day?
Wow.
And for Easter, 1.5 billion consumed.
So they eat 1.5 billion peeps, but they only eat, what, 90 million chocolate bunnies? What the... You know what? I am so glad I'm Canadian. That's all I gotta say.
Apparently, 180 million eggs, including regular eggs, are purchased for Easter. And
yeah, that makes sense.
In the U.S., they have the egg roll tradition at the White House, right? This is a tradition that started in 1878.
Egg roll tradition?
Yeah. They have an egg hunt in the White House lawn. They also have an egg roll. Like, they roll the egg. I'm not sure why, but it's kind of a race, I guess. Brent, maybe you can explain it.
Well, it's actually very interesting. They like to watch it roll.
Like, what are they rolling it with?
I think it's a spoon.
I think I did something like that for like sports day back in like
sports day. What kind of sports is that?
I'm the only American here, and I'm like
more confused than all of y'all on this. We do that. It's a thing we do.
Apparently, it's a thing.
I'm just envisioning one of those Hot Wheel tracks down that White House staircase and rolling eggs.
Oh, that would be so fun with the little loop. Get it going faster.
Yeah. I would like to see a slinky going down the stairs.
Me too.
The biggest egg hunt actually is in Winter Haven, Florida.
Cool.
Yeah, so it's not far from you, Brent.
Oh, yeah, that's just down the street.
And apparently, they hunt.
It is down the street, Brent, like 5 hours, six?
Everything's like five, down the street from Brent.
You know, it's a big street.
It's a really long street. And apparently, they hide 501,000 eggs for people to find.
But they're only selling 1.8 billion. That's not very many.
I don't know. That bunny's producing a lot of eggs.
Wow. Okay.
And last but not least, there's 175 different Hallmark cards available for Easter.
Of course, it's a Hallmark holiday.
Sort of.
How many facts was that? Was that your top 10?
No, there was more than 10 facts.
Oh,
but, you know,
okay. Well,
it was kind of, it replaced our top 10.
Absolutely.
That's why we couldn't
thank you.
Do.
I appreciate it. Save me some work.
That would be the top 17, and that just sounds weird. Like,
sometimes when I do this, I could easily do a top 20.
Do you guys have any fond memories about Easter? I mean, I don't know. Easter was never super important for me. I mean, a lot of people that have like traditions, stuff like that. I mean, I grew up, Easter was almost not even as more banal than Christmas. Here's a basket with some chocolate in it. That was it.
It was a food holiday for my family.
Yeah.
And a good food holiday because it meant ham and.
We didn't. Yeah. I don't think we even had a feast when I was growing up.
We are tonight.
Oh, are we?
Okay. Yeah, just by fluke.
I always remember every Easter getting pissed because, like, we lived like 30 minutes away from our church, and so we'd go to church early in the morning, and then we'd take 30 minutes to come back home, and then we had like what, like 15, 20 minutes, and they'd be like, "Okay, we got to go back to church again."
What?
Of the thing. I'm like, "Why the fuck did we even come home?"
I went to Sunday school, but no, you know, like I think for the most of the time I went to Sunday school, even my sister didn't go. So,
well,
wasn't a big part of Easter for us.
Well, Brent was raised more like evangelical, and probably you as well, right, Darryl? I'm assuming.
Yeah. No, what Brent was saying, the half hour, and then you're barely home in time to don't even change, take a bite to eat, and you're back off to church again.
I was raised Catholic, so for me, church, it was like, it was once every Sunday there, and it's like, oh, I had more of my fill for another week. You know?
No, for me, I know that at the church I went to, they did stuff for Easter, but because my mom wasn't a part of that church, I didn't have to do any of that stuff. I got away with it.
Okay, well, that's cool. That works.
Lucky.
Perfect.
Lots of turkey and ham, though.
Yeah.
Well, my mom also would make this weird, like, pie thing. I was just telling Nikki about it. Like, it's this weird, like, it's like a giant donut, basically. But it's got hard-boiled eggs in it.
Oh,
like, it's like, the bread, you know what about? It's like this weird cinnamon bread stuff. And then it has hard-boiled eggs, like, baked into it.
Weird.
And the shells get all in the bread. And it's just a nut. Like, why
don't you peel the eggs? Does she cook them raw?
They're colored. Like, they color them for, you know, we all dyed them the day before.
Okay, so.
And the crocodile eggs, too.
The bread.
Yeah, crocodiles.
The crocodile eggs.
Down there? Alligators.
Alligator eggs out as well, you know.
So
you take a bite of that pie. And it bites back at you.
You got some weird traditions down there. My mom no chocolate eggs, hard-boiled eggs and bread?
Yeah,
without peanuts. What like, the...
Shells, it was...
Did I wake up in a different dimension today? I think I did.
Poor Brent.
I've heard of this probably didn't happen for Brent, but I think it's called a king cake, and they like cook babies in it.
No, no, that's not it.
Then that's, oh, that's not an the king atheist cake.
Thing. No, we do that.
with the plastic babies, little babies. That's the king cake, isn't it?
And, not quite. And, it's not quite. What would the
create cut in half babies?
No, would
that's even better.
Originally, they used to cook a cake, and they would put a uncooked bean in there. Okay. And when you found the bean, you kind of got a prize.
Yeah.
And later on, it became a little piece of plastic that was like the effigy of a king or the effigy of a queen or something like that. And, you know, it's just a surprise in the cake. And if you get the piece, you get a gift.
Yeah,
like
but that. I think that they put babies in.
So when Grandpa finds it, he's missing his three front teeth. But he found his
teeth. He found it. But
my friend's mom used to bake money. She would like
bake money.
Bake money into a cake, so it would be like a money cake, and she would wrap it. Obviously, she wouldn't. It would be wrapped in plastic or something, and that would be her birthday cake. So you would always hope to get the one with the biggest amount of money in it. Would be like a dollar bill or something. Back, that's how old I was. Yes, we still had dollar bills back.
Would my luck to probably get one with a bill? You owe us here.
I think I got a quarter once. Yeah, nothing huge.
All right, Brent, my friend, do you have another brilliant moment for us?
I do. Brought I do. Another brilliant moment brought to you by religion. Cue the music.
It's already on.
Sorry.
It's a good thing we're professionals.
No, so the Elijah List, if you're not familiar, is this show. Basically, I believe it's a YouTube show, but I think it's from a website as well. It's probably my favorite show for ironic viewing pleasure.
Ironic viewing pleasure?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm gonna
each
love
week,
this
Mr.
Channel.
Potato Head, or...
Is this so called Mr. Potato Head?
I can't help it, man. He looks like Mr. Potato Head. Steve Schultz, sorry.
Not Mr. Potato. It's not the real Mr. Potato Head.
I totally thought it was.
He interviews a different absurd Trump prophet or prophetess.
Oh, God.
My.
That manages to now get more and more crazy each week.
Wait, is this on YouTube?
And they sent out a newsletter, and they're promoting their new prophetess. Which, by the way, I didn't even know that was allowed. I mean, I'm pretty sure in the evangelical circles, that's not allowed.
No, it's not.
Women prophets.
Women aren't allowed to speak.
Yeah. Exactly.
When men are in the room, they're not allowed to speak if they've been baptized.
Yeah, but they don't care as long as they get the new prophet smell. It's like getting like a new car.
They have to cover their hair. Because if they don't cover their hair, God thinks they're bald.
So what if she is? Does it matter?
These days it don't matter, but yeah, anyway. Keep going.
But so yeah, they just seem to get crazier and crazier, and this poor Mr. Potato Head guy has to interview him and just sit there and look like he's interested as they're basically telling him their dreams. Their dreams, the most boring thing anybody could ever say to anybody. It's like literally the thing where you're just like, yeah, I don't care, dude. Yeah, I don't care about your dream, bro. And he made a channel out of it.
Of course.
Poor guy. I feel terrible for him. And he looks like he's questioning his choices every single episode. he does not look happy.
So,
Veronica West, and she spells it with a K at the end.
What?
Veronica, with a K.
Is it those one of those silent K things again?
No, it's Veronica. So, it's a C, it's a K.
Like, nobody spells it now. Okay. Veronica West, she recounts a vision that she believes means that God is still using Trump to usher in the new kingdom era.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, man. So, all right, here's the vision. And then I got an interpretation as well. Just
I love it when vision needs interpretation. I love it when vision needs interpretation. I love it.
Yeah. And it's... It's all more confusing than the... Anyway. So the vision is a stairway to heaven made of living, multicolored stones.
Living stones? Cool. Okay.
Yeah, I guess they're alive. I don't know how you'd even know. I guess they're pulsing or something. They had a pulse?
Maybe they breathe.
I don't know. They're alive, though. They're a multicolored stone, which they have the word Trump, or the name Trump, appeared in gold in ascending order, starting from the bottom, touching the nations, which basically just means from the ground, to the highest heights. Highest heights is just repetitive. In heavenly places. Right. So, and this is so funny. Each letter of Trump's name appeared with a corresponding word. Right? So, and it's truth, righteousness, unity.
You're so funny.
Mercy. And peace. All the, it's just like the opposite. The opposite day of Trump. Like what is? Ah, it's like anything that's like the opposite of Trump. Truth, really? That's your starter. Anyway, Jesus. And then all of a sudden it abruptly changes from that image, I guess, to a different image, which is a rainbow whirlwind comes out of a door on a dead tree, filled with animals. Okay, let me say that one more time.
I'm waiting for the translation here.
Thank God you got the translators.
Whirlwind comes out of a door on a dead tree filled with animals.
Is it like so, is it like a really cheap version of Noah's Ark or something?
That's what it sounds like to me.
They didn't have time to make a boat. They just
put the interpretation. Maybe that's exactly what it says.
Already thinking too much, Kevin. Already. So the animals are an eagle, of course, because you know Trump and America, a snake eating an owl, and just in a. They're spinning around in this whirlwind in a perpetual fight to the end, I guess. Just a roar of a lion. So, I mean, that's not even a full animal.
Not the full lion.
Yeah, it's just the noise of the alien. Or the animal. Alien. The face of a lamb. Some lamb's poor face.
Maybe the lamb was roaring.
Flying around.
Like a lion.
Like he was from the movie Silence of the Lambs or something. And a dove. Okay, so here's the interpretation. And it's more confusing than the vision somehow. I have no idea how you did that. It seems to be kind of difficult. God is establishing his ecclesia. Ecclesia. I think it's ecclesia. And I looked this word up. It doesn't mean what they think it means. It has nothing to do with it. It's a Greek word for... Never mind. It just means to be called out or something. Anyway. For a church that rules... But they think it means it's a church that rules the world. That's their version of what they think that word means.
Okay.
And Trump speaks of the new kingdom, the reformation movement, being birthed on earth. And Trump is the anointed one for this new kingdom era.
Okay.
Try to figure that shit out.
Yeah, okay, you did confuse me. Maybe we should repeat that again.
God is establishing his ecclesia, a church that rules the world. And Trump speaks of the new kingdom reformation movement being birthed on earth. And Trump is the anointed one for this new kingdom era.
You know, anybody, any God would actually anoint Trump. It's just ridiculous to begin with. Right. I mean, Jabba the Hutt would make a better anointed one than Donald Trump.
Are they saying he's supposed to be ruling the world? Like, I don't understand.
I think they try to confuse you on purpose so that you just go, yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Well, I think it looks like
you're one of the followers, you know? You don't want to look like an outsider, but, huh?
Like what I call the nod-along. And when we, in religious folks, like, we all had to kind of do the nod-along.
Absolutely.
When somebody called themselves a prophet, you kind of just nodded, like, yeah, sure. Totes my goats, my bros. Yeah.
You're so true. I remember that in church. What you said.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, if this whole podcast thing doesn't work, maybe we should just go become prophets, because it seems to be such an easy thing now.
Right?
Just
walk up to you and smack you on the forehead until you're healed, and then you can stand up and start walking and pretend that you were paralyzed before.
Yeah, and I can take a bit of LSD and have a wacky dream, and then I'll just call
them. Get some snakes?
Yeah, get some snakes.
Start speaking in tongues. That's really easy.
Oh, yeah, the tongues is so easy.
Yeah. We can do this. Who needs a job?
Totally just did it. I said like a whole paragraph to God. You didn't even know.
I love it. God spoke to me. I heard it. Maybe you said it. I can't. Anyway, where a guy, God told him to look out the window right at the right time when he was in an airplane, and he saw the Tower of Babel. What were we listening to? Oh my God! My eyes kept getting bigger. I'm like, what? I could just sit on a plane and go, I looked out the window and I saw the Tower of Babel, and of course I'm telling the truth, God spoke to me.
And it's another one of those prophets. So again, like, there's like more, should be like a Wikipedia of all the prophets. Because they're getting more and more.
What were we listening to? I can't
remember either, but it's like,
It was hilarious.
It's like if they came to like regular people and just said some shit like that. Like, I was up in my airplane and I saw the Tower of Babel when I looked out the window, and everybody's like, dude, are you fucking crazy? Like, oh, well, it was a vision from God. And we're like, okay.
Christians just buy it. And yet, those same Christians are ragging on the Mormons for believing in John Smith. Yeah. It's like John Smith, Jesus. Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Oh, no, it's not Jesus who came down with the Ten Commandments.
Moses.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I'll quote Bill Maher here. You know, I don't always agree with Bill Maher, but one time he did say that when you're the new religion on the block, you have to out-crazy the others. And it's true.
You know what? When you really sit there and look at Christianity, it's just as fucking crazy as Mormonism.
Oh, it's just as insane.
If not more so, especially when you think about all the stuff that's not in the Bible.
You know, the funny thing is about Mormonism, I like the idea of, you know, getting my own planet after I die. You know, it's kind of cool. When you think about it, there's a really vast universe. You get your own planet. That's kind of cool. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, cool. I'm cool. I'm happy with that.
Explanation for all those useless planets that are out there just doing nothing, you know?
Of course, I'll probably get, like, Pluto or something. Like, you get a dwarf planet.
You get to make up your own crazy rules for your own planet then, too?
Absolutely. Yeah. You rule it, right?
Yeah, it's like Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Let's be Mormon. Like, you guys can throw whatever you want, man.
Any of those nifty underwear? Anyway.
I love it.
Oh, religion. No wonder it's crazy.
Yeah, no kidding, eh?
That's the funny thing about being an atheist. The longer you are a non-believer, the more absurd the stories get that you might
think.
I can't believe.
Do you find yourself feeling pity for people that you see online who are so obviously,
of course,
snowed by religion, and you really want to, like, help them because they seem so lost, but, like, there's nothing you can do to help them. Nothing. Like, no matter what you say to them, they're still gonna, like, go back to, but God is real. And it's like, okay. Alright.
Yeah, it's like half pity and half rage.
Yeah, because you can't get through to them that, like, just live your life for today, not for what might happen when you die. Like, fuck, you die, and then you die.
Yeah, but sorry. Like you said, it's rage, but not rage because of the argument. Rage because you're trying to help them.
And because they've just, you feel so sorry because they've been brainwashed. Like,
it's like you just want to shake him and wake up, dude. What are you doing?
Yeah. It's, as I get older,
like and the fact that I was there, I believe this. I need to say exactly what you just quoted from somebody else, to clearly that you quoted somebody else. Like, because that's the way it works. It's like everybody just listens to somebody else and fucking repeats it.
There's no
thinking.
Remember being like 5 or 6 and questioning, maybe 7, because, like I said, I didn't come from, like, birth up religious. I didn't even know about God, quote unquote, until I was like 6. And some church came and knocked on our door and said, would you like to send your kids to Sunday school? My mom said, sure. And, and honestly, I don't regret it. I will be completely honest. I 100% do not regret going to Sunday school for a lot of things.
Oh, you're off the podcast now.
But, no, there's a lot of things I do.
I'm muting your button.
But
I'm muting your button. That's it. You're muted. No, you can't hear you anymore.
So, It's too bad he has control of that. But I can remember questioning them and like being. Then we were talking about the faith moving mountains, that story in the Bible, and if you just have a mustard seed of faith, and all these kids are in the room, and I can remember us all going, "But we are big faith. We have all this faith. We believe." And they're like, "No, you don't." And they're like, "If you did, you could move mountains." And we're like, "But we do believe. We're sitting here. We're telling you. No, you don't."
It would appear as a mustard seed in your hand, dude. Yeah. That's how faith works. Like you'd be able
it'd be nice if at least we have the record of one mountain moving.
Right?
You know, at least you have something.
But the reality is that as an adult, you look back on that, you realize how bad you were getting gaslit and brainwashed at such a young age. And I'm so very glad that I woke up. But it's just
well, because how are we dealing in units of faith? Yeah. Like, how does that make sense? Like, mm-hmm. it's like, hey, all you need is a mustard seed of it. Okay, well, how much is that?
Yeah.
Well, how do we figure this? Anyway.
Yeah, well, and just to have the...
I don't know what a mustard seed is. I get it in my chicken feed sometimes.
You have chickens. Okay, no, we're not going down that tangent.
That's the amount of faith you need. Just
I miss my chickens, for the record.
And this is why they call it a virus. This is why they call it the God virus.
So that's where the legit anger that we were mentioning a bit ago, like, I get angry at kids getting taught that and not being allowed to think and ask questions and
We were literally told to shut up and listen, basically. Yeah. And maybe in those words, too, if I were, you know, who knows.
Well, thank you so much for that, Brent. Speaking of God virus, our next guest is going to be Dr. Darrel Ray. We'll be talking about human sexuality in these times of COVID and QAnon. Ooh. So let's have a quick pause, and when we come right back, we'll be with Dr. Darrel Ray. So stay with us.
Listen to the Sacrilege Cast podcast, YouTube video, interview program that features me talking to some of the best and brightest in the atheist/secular/awesome community. I interview people. We curse and usually drink beer because why not? It's the Sacrilege Cast, Z-A-C-H-R-I-L-E-G-E, and I can spell it after two beers so you can too.
I'm Amy with a Y.
And I'm Amy with an I.
And we're the hosts of Secular Soup, where each week we offer up a bowl of real talk about atheism, feminism, politics, parenting, and whatever else we want to talk about because it's our podcast.
Just listen to what these random dudes are saying about our show.
This is what would happen if Daria and Jane grew up and started a podcast.
So if you like extremely foul-mouthed ladies with opinions, this is the podcast for you.
Grab a bowl and taste the magic. Slurp even this.
I've heard people say that too much of anything is not good for you, baby. But I don't know about that. As many times as we've loved and we've shared love and made love, it doesn't seem to me like it's enough. It's just not enough for you. It's just not enough. Oh, my darling.
My darling, I can't get enough of your love, babe.
Okay, now, this music can only mean one thing. We have the high priest of the Church of the Flying Spaghetti Monster. He is a doctor in psychology on human sexuality. He's also the author of Sex and God and the God Virus. And a good friend of ours, Dr. Darrel Ray, is with us. Dr. Ray, thank you so much for being with us.
Glad to be back, and I took my clothes off so we can
excellent. It's not a show unless Dr. Darrel Ray is naked with us.
Fantastic.
Dr. Ray has probably been the most returned guest on our show, so we're always pleased to have him.
Why haven't you made him a co-host yet?
Well, you know, he's a busy guy, you know. He's got better things to do to hang with us. But
important things to do.
Dr. Ray, for those of us who might not have heard your fabulous voice in the past, and shame on them if they have not, can you give us a quick bio as to who Dr. Darrel Ray is?
Well, some people would say I'm a pervert, but I think I'm just a very liberated sexual human being. There you go. I like you said, I'm the author of several books, and I'm actually, the thing I'm most proud of is starting and recovering from religion and the Secular Therapy Project, which I hope we get a little bit of time to talk about here today.
We always have a little bit of time.
Absolutely. All right, that's good. I'm passionate about helping people get away from religion and helping them on their journey so they can have the best life they can live. Mm-hmm. And I think there's lots of tools that we in psychology can use to help people, and that's kind of been my life's mission, to help educate people about the damage that psychology bring that religion brings, and how the psychology can help people.
Mm-hmm. So while we're at it, we might as well go into the recovering from religion. What are the news, the latest things of what's happening with recovering from religion there?
The latest thing is the last year we thought COVID was really going to screw us up, and we stopped in our tracks right after the pandemic hit and said, what are we going to do? How are we going to do it? And we totally reorganized ourselves for the pandemic. And the direct result of that is we've seen 100% increase
in
the number of clients, chats, and volunteers, and phone calls.
Fantastic.
And we had 100% over last. We had 100% increase every year for three straight years. But we thought, we'd be really hit. But we've actually thrived in this environment. So I'm very happy to report that.
That's awesome.
Hundreds and hundreds of phone calls, hundreds and hundreds of chats every month. People coming to us from all over the world. We've now got volunteers. And if any of the listeners are interested, they can go volunteer for us. But we have volunteers in 16 different time zones right now. Literally,
wow.
Literally from South Africa to Germany to England to Australia, all over. We got a lot of volunteers from Canada. In fact, sometimes it looks like we're being invaded by the Canadians. There was a time, like about 3 months, 4 months ago, when we had more volunteers from the United Kingdom, Canada, and Australia combined than from the United States.
Wow.
Joining us, volunteering. So I don't know what's going on, but the Aussies were really hitting us from the west, and the Brits were hitting us from the east, and you guys were invading from the north.
Yep.
So we're happy to have an enormous international number of... We've got over 275 volunteers now, and they're working in all different capacities. The main function, though, is a chat line and a phone line. So people can call us, and they can literally call us directly from five different countries, South Africa, United Kingdom, Canada, United States, and Australia. We pay for direct the ability to call from those countries.
Mm.
And you can chat from anywhere on the planet. We have had chats just in the last week from India and Pakistan. We get regular chats from places like Tunisia and occasionally even from places like Saudi Arabia. Pretty crazy to be chatting with us. You can get your head cut off for talking to us sometimes.
Yeah,
so
mm-hmm.
We're pretty careful about that.
I got a question I've had for a long time. I've never asked you, Darryl. Do you sometimes get like prank calls, you know, like from theists that try to just to preach to a line like this?
You know, the interesting thing is we rarely do. We get calls from people that you would, you know, we have actually protocols. We train our agents really well. You don't touch our clients unless you really know what the fuck you're doing. And we train our people how to handle trolls. And it's kind of funny. People will call into us or chat into us, and it looks like they're trying to troll us. But because we use good, compassionate questioning, and we never buy into their bullshit, we actually convert a pretty good number of them into having a reasonable conversation.
Wow.
It's actually kind of funny to see a troll
saying, awesome.
Oh, well, maybe I do need to think about this a little harder. Now, it doesn't happen every time, but long ago, we've got protocols. You know, if you don't want to, we're here to help people. We're not here to argue or debate. We're not here to convert or deconvert. That's not our job.
Mm-hmm.
And our volunteers are very well trained. If somebody comes in and they're a troll, you have every right to just say, here's some resources. We'll go look at them and don't come back.
Mm-hmm. And Darryl, while I have you here, you are also going to be one of the speakers at Court 2021, right?
Yeah, looking forward to that. It's going to be a first. We were supposed to have it last April, but of course the COVID killed that.
Mm-hmm.
But we're going to do it online. And these online conferences are working pretty well. In fact, all weekend I've been working our own booth at American Atheist Convention remotely in my own home. We've had all of our board members involved in helping people understand what we do. We come from religion. It works pretty well, so I think Court's going to go well as well. But the reason we're so excited about it is we want to bring to the forefront the notion that religion causes trauma,
mm-hmm.
that there's a root cause of childhood trauma is religion, and let's stop giving religion a pass. Let's name it, and let's do something about it. I mean, the kid that's at 5 years old is getting beaten by his parents because he didn't memorize his Bible verses.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
That's religious abuse,
mm-hmm.
and it doesn't take a big leap of imagination to realize if that goes on too long, that becomes religious trauma.
Absolutely,
and that it's not just beating; it's psychological abuse. It's terror. You know, you're going to hell if you don't obey us. Obey your parents or that sort of bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
And so you get kids getting to be adults, and then of course the social isolation, the lack of social skills and interaction that happen in groups like Jehovah's Witnesses or Mormons, you know. So what we see, and we're going to be talking about this at court next month in May, is these things are right in front of our faces, but nobody has named it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
A person who is extremely anxious and they can't get out of their head that the apocalypse might happen or I might be left behind, even if I'm an atheist. I could be a fucking atheist and still have these, you know, fears come out just spontaneously.
Yeah, we see this crosses my mind every once in a while.
We see this almost every day at Recovering from Religion. People call in or chat in and say, I can't get out of my head that the apocalypse is going to happen. I'll never see my parents again. You know, that sort of bullshit. And so that is actually a symptom of trauma.
Hmm.
It's much like the soldier that comes back from Iraq and he can't sleep at night for fear a sniper's got his, you know, shooting at him.
Mm-hmm.
That's trauma. When you see that kind of behavior, it doesn't matter where it comes from, a war in Iraq, or whether it comes from an earthquake in Italy, or whether it came from a Jehovah's Witness child being raised in that cult. And, oh, by the way, what we're seeing, and I'm going to push this hard at the conference, what we're seeing is high control religions, like Jehovah's Witnesses, like Mormons, like Scientology, they are the tip of the iceberg. We get so many calls and chats from Catholics that are scared shitless, you know, and they're ashamed of their body. They can't properly express themselves sexually. They can't have good relationships with other sexual relations, other people. They're ashamed because they're gay. You know, there's all sorts of things. And people think, well, religion's only a problem with the cults. And I'm here to tell you, religion's a problem with 90% of period. Now, obviously, the Unitarians are kind of loosey-goosey. The Quakers are, too. And you can be gay or whatever with those groups. But they're a tiny sliver of what we would consider religious. And the Baptists and the Catholics are just as devastating to children and youth when they condemn them for being gay, when they condemn them for masturbating, you know, when they condemn them for having sex before marriage, when they force purity rings on girls in front of their fathers and their whole family. I mean, it's just so much bullshit going on that leads to trauma. I know you didn't want me to do my whole trauma spiel, but that's what I'm doing.
No, that's perfectly fine, and I think that's a big message, because even a lot of people don't realize that maybe there's a difference between the mentality in the States and Canada, but as a Canadian point of view, a child that's been traumatized by religion is a drain on the healthcare system down the road.
It is.
Absolutely.
So we all end up paying for it, and America doesn't see that the same way, but we could take the extreme that a person can become violent because of that, but even if it's not violence that is the result, the psychological trauma is something we all end up paying for down the road.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I did want to ask like a quick question real quick, or sort of just like, you know, I had when I was growing up, my mom was like totally enamored by this satanic panic thing.
I'm sorry.
You know, and I remember her playing albums of somebody, his name is Mike Warnke, and I don't know if you're familiar with him. He was
a little bit.
He was a comedian, and he would do these like really weird, just like short sort of like jokes, a bunch of them, these like real quick, just like one-liners. And then in the middle, he'd start talking about, you know, Satanists like mutilating babies and stuff. Like, it was just so like out of the fucking blue. And I remember my mom like being completely believing this stuff and telling us about it and playing us the albums and stuff like that, you know, and talking about, you know, this same. He it turned out he was a complete fucking fraud.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the claims that he made were demonstrably false, you know, but that doesn't stop, like, you know, the fear of me. Like, I remember one of the things that she would say is that, you know, once he decided to be a Christian, he was a Satanist high priest. Once he decided to be a Christian, the demons would come to him at night and throw him out of his bed at night, you know, which was terrifying to a child. Like, that's fucking terrifying. Like, yeah, oh my God, like, and I'm like wondering if I'm still like, you know, because I have insomnia and stuff, and I'm like almost wonder if like some of that is still tied to that bullshit. Like,
it absolutely could be, and the explanation can be found. What I'm going to mention here is, or go over, I'm going to briefly, Kevin, with your permission, talk about that just a little bit, because that's a key component. There's a reason why religions want to get you when you're young, because your rational immune system has not developed. You don't have the capacity, the thinking capacity, to resist bad ideas. So that's the best time to put a bad idea into a human brain is when the human brain is very young and going through developmental phases early on. And as we know, the prefrontal cortex of the human brain doesn't develop until somewhere between 20 and 25 years of age.
Mm-hmm.
So if you could get people in a position of subservience, in a position where they have to listen to you, and that's what a five-year-old child has to do.
Mm-hmm.
A five-year-old child has no choice. They're totally dependent on their caregiver.
Mm-hmm.
If the caregiver's sitting there telling them, you're going to go to hell, they have no way of knowing the difference. For example, if you were a hunter-gatherer, you know, in the Amazonian forest, and your parents said, don't go that direction because the panthers will kill you and eat you, if you listen to your parents, you're probably going to survive.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
But those same parents may say, no, don't go into this other bush because that's where the demons live, and they'll kill you and eat you. Well, you as a child have no way to discern which one is the truth and which one's not.
Mm-hmm.
So your brain just absorbs them both.
Yeah.
Mm.
And so ultimately you end up taking these beliefs, some useful and some very devastatingly bad, on into adulthood. And it's really difficult to get rid of these bad ideas once they're implanted in a child.
Mm-hmm.
There's, if you think about it, we're walking around today, no matter what your age is now, that five-year-old still lives inside your body. It's still there.
Yeah.
Some of the memories, some of the experiences, some of the body memories, it's there. And so you carry that around, and it does take some time, effort, and probably therapy. I'll just throw that in there for you to be able to reprogram your brain, because that's what you're really having to do. Your mother, your father, in this case your mother, really programmed you with that bad idea. And until you do a concerted effort to reprogram it, you may continue to experience insomnia or things like that. Now, I'm not here to diagnose you. Don't get me wrong. I don't know if that's
true. Let's do it. Come on. Let's make it a whole thing. We can do that. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, yeah. Well, I must tell you that, you know, as far as Brent is concerned, his five-year-old is still touching him inappropriately.
He's a dick.
No, I don't agree with that. But anyway, that was a big detour for what's not the subject today.
I didn't mean to do that.
That's okay, man. That's okay.
He wanted some free therapy is what he wanted.
But today we are talking about QAnon. We talk about sexual purity. We're also talking about COVID. And maybe let's start with that, because we're still in COVID. Dr. Ray, as a psychologist and having your ear basically listening out there, what's going on, has there been a lot of effects from COVID on human sexuality as a whole at this point?
You know, I don't have any scientific evidence. I can say what I see and I hear from people. I think there's a lot of a lot of isolation. I think there's a lot of people feeling very lonely. And, of course, sex is one way to connect with a human, with another human being. I mean, when you can't even fucking hug somebody. And I don't know, you've been around me a little bit, Kevin. I love hugging people. And I'm a big hugger. I like being hugged.
Mm-hmm.
With permission, of course. But
oh, yes.
Fact is that if you can't even hug somebody, that human connection just has been severed in our culture. And I see people struggling with that. I see people who just got divorced, maybe before COVID. Or I see people who were stuck in a relationship because of COVID. I mean, if you're in the same house and you can't leave because of COVID and there's nowhere for you to move, or if you're living with your parents or you had to come back from college and move back in with your parents because of COVID, all these things are happening. And I think they have a direct impact on people's sexual expression and their sexual development. I think we'll probably see, and I'm just spitballing here, 2, 3, 4 years from now, I think we're going to look back and see some outcomes with respect to human sexuality that are a direct result of that, of the COVID. But I don't have any data to go on that.
Yeah, I mean, for example, Japan's been experiencing lately, they're throwing an alert that some of an entire generation of people don't seem to be able to interact with the opposite sex, much even less actually being sexually active. Would COVID have a potential to actually throw an entire generation that way?
Well, you know, we're already seeing that in the United States. In fact, this is not just a Japanese thing. I think Japanese are ahead of the curve mm-hmm. on this. Mm-hmm. I think part of it's got to do with technology. I think part of it's got to do with the way sexual mores are changing. I think part of it's got to do with the fact that there's been a real plateau in population growth, which is a good thing. I mean, we don't need a lot more people on this planet. So there's a number of things, and I would look at each culture. I have friends that are actually pretty deeply embedded in Japanese culture. One of them is a Canadian friend of mine. What I'm going to guess at, and you know, I don't have any science on this, is my friends in Japan say that culture has really gone through a massive change. And it's not necessarily related to religion, as it would be in the United States. Mm-hmm. It's related to extremely deeply embedded patriarchal culture. Not religiously necessarily, but, Japan's been a pretty strong patriarchal culture. And women's rights are pretty low on the totem pole. I mean, women are not allowed into the workplace very near the rates that you would see in other developed countries. Mm-hmm. So as Japanese come to grips with this, and as they come to grips with the fact that there's an aging population and there's fewer people around that are of mating age, all those things start impacting. We also know that in some animals, if you change certain parameters around the animals, they stop mating. So we may be in a massive human experiment where we've changed the parameters around relationships and people are going to stop mating. You just think about this. If it were not for immigration, the United States would be declining in population right now. If it were not for immigration, Italy would have long since declined in population.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of Western countries where the birth rate is not at replacement rate. China was there and is still there to some degree. So, there's benefits for reducing the amount of population. We're a parasite on this planet. So we have a high parasite load in terms of humans loading the planet with their demands. Mm-hmm. And so there's nothing wrong with reducing the number of parasites that are sucking on the resources of this planet. However, it does have direct impact on how we relate to each other. I mean, you got to think of this at two different levels. Planetary level, let's reduce the population mm-hmm. because we can't sustain it that we're at. And cultural level, That's a direct threat to whatever the local culture is, and we can talk about that a little bit later. And at the individual level, it means I may have a hard time finding a mate that satisfies whatever the criteria that my biology and child-rearing practices when I was a baby put in my brain. Because quite frankly, there's a lot of evidence that shows you create and learn your sexual preferences pretty early in life. So that, I mean, it's obvious as the nose on your face when you look at it. There are cultural differences. I mean, there's cultural differences between Japan and the way females in Japan look, dress, act, and the way people in Northern Europe, I mean, in Northern United Kingdom, in England, look, dress, and act. And those differences are radically different than the people, some tribes and peoples in South Central Africa. Those differences are biological. For example, I've been to England a lot. I've noticed that the Northern England women are large-breasted, far more than you will see in most other countries. But you go to Japan, you'll find that most women don't have large breasts in Japan. They're very small-breasted. And then when you go to South Central Africa, and there are some cultural groups who the females have steropygia, which is just enormously large butts, and those are seen as extremely attractive in that area, sexually attractive. Mm-hmm. So what we're seeing, I'm just using this to help you understand where I'm going here. Cultures, we literally breed ourselves.
Mm.
But through our preferences, we breed ourselves towards a certain desirable ideal, if you will. And that's why women developed big butts or women developed big breasts, because we're creating preferences, and those people that meet those preferences are going to be able to mate. And yeah, it's just evolution.
Yeah,
just evolution going on. Well, so that's kind of high level, big picture stuff.
Mm.
And then when you drill down a bit and you look at a little bit more in a fine grain, we could be doing that at a much smaller, lower, more subtle way. In the way, for example, one of the big complaints of South Central African women is that men no longer find them attractive once they've gotten brainwashed with the Western ideals of sexual desirability.
Mm.
So boys growing up at 5, 6, 7 years old, they're being exposed to Western ideals in South Central Africa, grow up desiring the body type and that they see in magazines or on TV, and they don't desire the body type that's sitting right next to them or is in their neighborhood that has a big butt, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So we're seeing this cross-culturally coming on, and it is literally disrupting the mating habits of our species.
That's interesting. Hold on, guys. I got to put this on pause for half a second. I got an email. Brent, you can't use a company credit card to buy a flight to Ireland, okay? I don't care how big those breasts are there. You just can't do that, man.
Look, I'm doing what I can with what I've got. And it makes sense. Because big butts are better. I mean, I'm just thinking, whatever. Everybody can. I know I'm in the Western world, but we're stupid over here. Okay. I mean, QAnon's evidence of that. I mean, clearly, we don't know who to fuck.
And that is a fantastic segue, Brent. Speaking
what's
of QAnon,
this company credit card we're talking about.
Yeah, I'll
get you the number later.
I'll get you the number.
Speaking of QAnon, this is one of the recent phenomena that's actually happened, and there's been kind of a resurgence in what they call purity and purity laws and stuff like that, and sexual purity. Darryl, you're on the forefront of all this stuff. What are psychologists saying about this new phenomenon?
Well, I don't know what psychologists are saying about it. I'm not doing that level research yet. I'm just doing my own little
She's stupid. That's stupid. That's what they're saying.
It's pretty bad. I'll tell you that. Mm-hmm. What I'm seeing when you January 6th, if you were paying attention, you know, you saw all the idiots on storming the U.S. Capitol.
Yep.
Well, there was a lot of Jesus stuff up there. There was, and you'll notice it was 80 or 90% males. It wasn't nearly as many females as were males storming the Capitol. Mm-hmm. There's a lot, and that's probably saying something. And as a result of that, I got to doing some other research and writing. I've been writing an article about this. But what I wanted to talk a bit about was how purity culture has helped create what we're seeing now is. What we're hearing is called QAnon, but it's also called other things. I mean, it's not just QAnon. It's the Boogaloo, or it's the Proud Boys, or it's the incels, or it's the men's rights, or it's the Christian nationalism. And what I'm here to say is all those things are rooted in the same thing.
Mm.
And that root goes way back. I mean, way back in at least in North American, certainly United States culture. And let's begin with the very founding of the United States, and the fact that it wasn't too long after the United States was founded, the notion of racial purity started creeping in, and which of course comes from the importation of enslaved people from Africa. So they end up being brought to the United States unwillingly, and then are not allowed to mate with anybody that doesn't match their particular color scheme.
Mm-hmm.
And as a result, we get this notion of racial purity, and from that comes sexual purity. Now, sexual purity goes back to more than just the Puritans. It goes clear back to early Christianity, of course, but it also goes back to early Islam. I mean, there's a lot of religions that have that notion. But I don't think you can, I do not think you can separate racial purity from sexual purity. The two are joined at the hip in the United States. And so what we're seeing is and then you've got to add on to that white supremacy and white male supremacy. So we got racial purity, got sexual purity, got white supremacy, got white male supremacy. You put all those pieces together, and within that is a purity culture. Purity in the sense that you should be purely, to be a pure Christian, you have to be a dominant male over a female's. So you got a misogynistic component to it.
Mm.
Purity culture. You've got to be in control of your own sexuality, and oh, by the way, you have to control women's sexuality too. Purity culture. You can't be gay and be pure. Gay being the actual embodiment of impure sexuality. I could just go through this list, Kevin, over and over again. Everything I'm mentioning here is a part of our deeply rooted foundation of North American culture. But especially United States culture. So what's that got to do with all those other groups I mentioned? Well, about 40 years ago or so, the purity culture started getting serious with the religious right, and they started implementing things like purity rings and having purity balls, where the daughter would go to with the ball with her father. Father would put a purity ring on her, and she would pledge never to have sex until she got married.
That is just an amazing thing. As soon as I saw that, I said, I've never actually seen that outside the U.S.
It was actually suggested in my church.
Really?
Yes.
I mean, wow. And it kind of makes sense, though, because, like, the whole thing about, you know, with religious stuff, it's less about, I mean, it's almost like the fucking English family, like the crown.
Yeah, similar.
You know? Because it's like, you know, the parents are the ones that are involved, it seemed, a lot. Like, when I was growing up, and like, you know, it was like this whole thing about, I can't think of the word, but it's like it's courting. That's
courting, right? Yeah,
yeah. And it's more about the parents than it seems than it is about the actual people that are in love.
But isn't it creepy as hell that you're putting you're pledging your to keep your virginity for your father? That's like, my God.
It's about ownership.
Yes, it's ownership.
The body. In this case, the father owns the daughter's body until she gets married, at which time the husband owns the daughter's body.
That's what we were taught in church.
It goes back to almost any patriarchal religion believes that, whether it be Islam. Scientology believes a version of that. So does Baptists believe it. Mormons certainly believe it.
And we still have some remnants of that, too, in just normal everyday. I mean, when you have a wedding, after all, the father of the bride gives her away, right? Uh-huh. She's a piece of meat or something, right?
Yep. Yeah, exactly.
It's funny, because I remember going to this whole I kissed dating goodbye. Yeah, that guy. And it's funny, too, because I went through this whole conference, where they did this, they basically dropped out, everything that you're talking about. And, and now, it's funny, because, he's actually an atheist now.
Yeah, he is.
Josh Harris, that was the writer of all this, is now an atheist. And it's funny, because, he was, and we had to live, I'm like, fuck you, man. I'm glad you're an atheist, but fuck you, man. You fucked up a lot of shit, man. We had to go to a conference to learn about how we shouldn't be kissing our wives until the wedding. A lot of us did that. A lot of, my friends and close, people that I was, that I knew, they would wait until the wedding to fucking kiss. Mm. That was just crazy to me.
It absolutely is. And that helps us understand what's going on with the current culture in QAnon, Boogaloo, Incel. There's this notion of sexual purity that, if you notice, what we were talking about here for the last few minutes was sexual purity as it was enacted in women and girls. Mm-hmm. What I want to do is I want to take that coin and flip it to the other side. Because while they were teaching girls sexual purity, putting rings on them, telling them they can't have sex before marriage, they were also giving similar but male, so-called male, appropriate messages to the boys. Mm-hmm. The boys are being basically taught that a girl who has sex before marriage is damaged. Mm-hmm. So the boy is getting this message. The boy is being taught if you masturbate, you will ruin your marriage. Mm. The boy is being taught if you violate a girl, that's probably not a big problem. Boys can get away with that. But the girl you violated now probably won't have a husband because she's been violated. And oh, by the way, men have a right to sex with or without permission. And so the marital bed is a requirement for the female, whoever's in that. And so you get all these components that are being told to men and boys that you have a right to sex, that non-consensual sex is one of those liberal ideas. Once you get married, your wife has to give you sex. There's a lot of messages that boys are getting at that age we talked about a little bit earlier with Brent mentioned, I think. At 5-6 years old, when you're being taught boys have to dominate women, and you're getting that message in not just in words, but in actions, you grow up to be a misogynistic asshole yourself as a teenager or as a young adult. And that's what we're seeing here in the QAnon. The people that, I mean, those guys, how many stories came out of the storming of the Capitol where these guys have never been married, they don't have kids, mm-hmm. they're living in their parents' basement. You know, the FBI came and pulled them out of their parents' basement after they... I mean, there's something going on there when you can't... You know, you'd rather go protest Trump's not getting elected than to, to treat women properly or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, and I hear the masturbation thing, and that's real big in white supremacist culture.
Absolutely, and you're absolutely right. The white supremacists are all about not masturbating because masturbation is non-manly.
Really?
A man that has to masturbate means he doesn't know how to get a woman, or he doesn't know how to dominate a woman.
To do it for
him. If you can't do that, then you're a pussy. Or you're a cuck. Now, do you know the word? Do you know where the word cuck? If you go look at QAnon literature, if you look at incel literature, if you look at Boogaloo literature, just look at any of these groups that I'm mentioning, you will see that they use the word cuck very frequently.
Oh, yeah.
Now, do you know the origins of the word cuck?
I know the Pornhub handle, but I don't
know. All right. let's learn a little bit here about basic biology, by the way. The word cuck comes from the fact that the cuckoo is a bird that lays its eggs in other birds' nests. They do not take care of their own babies. So they lay an egg in another bird's nest. It's usually a smaller bird. The cuckoo hatches quickest. So the cuckoo hatches first, the cuckoo baby. There are other eggs in that nest, and the cuckoo baby proceeds to either kill any other babies that were born in that nest or to push the eggs out. When the mother or father of the other bird species comes back, they feed the loudest baby, which is almost always the cuckoo. So then you end up getting a cuckoo baby being raised by parents of another species. Uh-huh. And the species doesn't know it's being parasitized because a cuckoo is a parasitic bird, basically what it amounts to.
Yeah.
So we've got cuckoo, and cuckoo means raising somebody else's baby. Well, that's what the Pornhub and that's what cuck means is, you can't control your own woman. She's out fucking somebody else, and that says you're less of a man. I know that's what it all, that's the narrative that's being used when they say, you're a cuck. That means you're too weak to control women, so you're a cuck, and somebody's probably fucking your woman while you're out of town or whatever. That's what's going on.
I'm quite relieved because I thought when you said cuckoo, I thought it had something to do with Cocoa Puffs. Well, so I'm quite relieved that it actually had to do with the bird and not the seal.
Oh, you and your daddy jokes.
Do you see how this all comes together when you understand the sexual narrative of QAnon, of Boogaloo? It's a male purity. Only pure males are going to be allowed into the kingdom of QAnon. Or get into the kingdom of white supremacy. And you've got, you can't be marrying somebody that's outside of your race, for example. You can't be gay, for example. There's a lot of things that create a purity mentality around things. And the cuck is one of, the cuck concept is only one of those.
That's why they always refer to alpha males. Alpha males here, alpha male there.
Yes. Oh, and the hilarious thing is all these guys calling themselves alpha males and they're anything but.
Yeah.
Not even a beta male.
It's so insecure. It's like, it's funny.
Exactly. And to understand what alpha male means, it's actually situational. You could be an alpha male in one situation and a non-alpha male in another.
Mm-hmm.
That's just the way hierarchies work in primate species.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. Wow.
That's fascinating.
So has there actually been because of incel and QAnon and all that, has there really been a resurgence of sexual purity things? Or do you think it's an outlier?
Oh no, I think sexual purity as taught to our children in public schools. I mean, think about this. Abstinence only is being taught in our public schools for the last 20 years under since the 90s.
Yep.
So abstinence only is a purity culture and is being taught to boys and girls.
Mm-hmm.
Well, those boys and girls are now of mating age. They're of reproducing age now and they don't fucking know how to fuck. I mean, think about that.
That is it. That's the problem right there. And then because the purity thing becomes such a central point in everything, the whole consent, birth control, all these other aspects are not being taught at all.
They don't know how to put a condom on. You're right.
They don't know what
a condom
is.
And as somebody, for me, as example, I like comedy a lot, and I like to make jokes and stuff like that.
you know, but because I was raised so repressed when it comes to this, I learned that sex is bad, and period, done talking, like that sex is bad, period. And it's like, it's because I didn't learn any of those other things. It's sexual comedy and stuff becomes very difficult for me because now that I am sort of not in that mind frame, I don't have a metric to determine what's okay and what's not okay to make a joke or you know what I mean? Like as far as just even how to talk about it. Mm-hmm. And yep. So I just don't. Mm-hmm. I don't, you know, I'm figuring it out more what's okay and what's not okay, you know, but it's like, it's taken me so long because of this shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know?
Right. have Darryl with a Y and he was raised Mennonite. Darryl, do you want to chime in on this? Has it been the?
Well, my finger's been hovering over the mute button here for a while, but I don't know when to interject. But
told you.
So much of what you said, about purity culture and what we're taught growing up in a Mennonite school, the whole objectification of women. If she's being transferred from her father's possession to your possession, you can't learn to communicate with any girl in your age group.
Yep.
The communication is difficult to do. Yep. And then what I think what Brent was saying, when you get out of that, learning the nuances of good guard, Darryl, get your words out. growing up in that, there's girls that you can't really talk to or anything, or you can't really talk much at all to, and then there's your wife who is your possession.
Yeah.
And trying to talk to somebody else who's not in those two categories is difficult.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then and then you got your daughter you got to talk to and raise.
Yes.
And you're raising her with misogynistic ideas, even though you're not intending to, maybe. You still, you carry those with you.
Wow.
Yeah, you totally do. Like, I had left the church shortly after my daughter was born, so she was only three or four. And yet, there's so many background things in my mind that it's difficult to go, or you flip-flop between the strict way you were born and absolutely no rules, because you don't know which ones are of value.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. Exactly.
Wow. It's very difficult as a woman to battle with internal misogyny.
Oh, yeah, we got a woman on the panel here.
We
today.
Do.
That's great. Hey.
Hey, I'm
what?
No, it's
a woman here?
Yeah. Well, I've been listening and absorbing a lot. There's a lot of internal misogyny that was really drilled into me, and a lot of it came from the church. Like I said earlier, I don't know, I was taught I wasn't allowed to speak in church. Once I was baptized, if I was in the presence of a man, I wasn't allowed to speak.
Must have been so hard for you.
It wasn't that hard. I was 12. And terrified. I was so terrified that God would see me as this horrible, bad person. And so I did everything they told me to do. I wore the coverings on my head. I didn't speak unless I was spoken to. I was terrified to go to Sunday school. My teacher was male. I'm like, how can we interact? I'm not allowed to talk unless... Mm. And they told, oh, no, that's different. You're in Sunday school. Of course.
So, Dr. Ray, after the sexual revolution of the 60s and all that, you would think that Christians would have a diminishing influence when it comes to sexual purity and stuff like that. But how come that's not the case? What is it that we're missing here?
Well, I actually heard a good lecture at the American Atheist Convention just this weekend on that very thing. And it was Catherine Stewart, author of the books on childhood brainwashing and school systems. I'm forgetting the name of it right now. Anyway, she was talking about how the religious right took a religious idea and politicized it, for specifically abortion, of course.
What the religious right did, because they were losing the battle over the 60s and 70s, they had to find some way to re-energize and engage their constituents. And the way they did that was to use Christian shame on women about abortion, and then push that narrative, starting with Jerry Falwell, of course, in the late 70s.
Of course.
So we've got a politicization of a concept that the Southern Baptists weren't even concerned about. Southern Baptists early on even had statements in their annual meetings about their support for women's rights for abortion. So it wasn't even an issue until they politicized it.
Yeah, and I remember being so upset about that. I remember as a child, they like would tell me about how some of these people, the left, just want to kill babies. And I remember being like, what the fuck? What are they doing?
Yeah.
Why did they? And I was like, you know, I'm like a 10-year-old...
impressionable kid.
Yeah, why the fuck are they trying to kill babies? Yeah, that doesn't even make sense.
Now
that
you've eaten a couple, you realize they're pretty tasty, right?
Of course they are.
The female side of the coin is, let's shame women for their bodies, mm-hmm. and shame them for having abortions, shame mm-hmm. them for having birth control, shame them for having sex before marriage. I mean, all those things are the female side of the message. But at the same time, the males are getting the male version of that same message, and that leads to notions of male dominance, mm-hmm. notions of male privilege, notions of hyper-masculinity, notions of male sexual purity around nofap, don't masturbate, don't have sex unless it's with a woman, and notions of male dominance in the sexual relationship, so you have the right to sex, and of course Christian male birthright, that Christian males are the top of the heap. All these things are purity culture ideas that men have been taught. Mm. So it's just as my contention is that the purity culture hurt men as much as it did women. We're just blinded by it. Mm. What we're seeing with QAnon is it's coming out in spades. This anger, this violence, this need to dominate other races and sexes is a direct result of male purity culture.
Yeah.
Period.
Wow.
So you think that is what's driving things like mass shootings and the violence?
I think there's a hell of a lot of evidence for that. Not in every case, of course, in many cases.
Wow.
I think you're right. I mean, look at that guy that killed all the Asian women.
Massage parlors.
And
we've been talking
Atlanta.
About that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he has now been saying that he was a porn addict. Well, you know what I think of that notion.
Yeah, he says he's a sex addict, and we all know it's bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right. So he was struggling. Well, what was he struggling with? He was struggling with notions of male dominance
mm-hmm.
and temptation and shame. The guy was probably masturbating way more than than Jesus wanted him to.
Yes.
and then he was going to have sex with people in massage parlors, which made him feel even more ashamed.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the only way to get rid of the shame is to kill the people that he identified as creating the problem in the first place.
Mm.
All of that comes directly from a very poisonous ideology, Christian ideology.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wow. I used to have a fucking guy call me every day to say, hey, you didn't masturbate today, right?
Really?
Uh-huh.
I'm dead serious. I know, it's funny. It is funny.
Brent, I was calling you. That was a joke I was doing with you, Brent. You know,
it was never a thing for... It wasn't something that was discussed with girls in church. I don't recall ever them telling us that it wasn't okay to masturbate. I don't even think I really knew what masturbation was until I was a lot older.
Mm, wow. Food for thought for sure. Dr. Ray, thank you so much for all this. That was great. The mic is all yours, my friend. If people want to find out more about Dr. Ray, your books, and what you're up to, where can they find you?
You can find me on Amazon, of course, The God Virus or Sex and God, either book.
Fantastic books.
And if you want to interact with me, you can send me an email to Darryl, and it's spelled properly, Darryl. at recovering from religion. And I would really encourage any listeners that are interested and need help, if you need help, if any of this stuff rings a bell with you and you want to talk to somebody, go to our recoveringfromreligion.org webpage, hit the chat button, and talk to one of our very well-trained volunteers. And if you need some help therapeutically, if you find yourself having trouble in sexual relationships because of your religion or anything like that, it doesn't have to be religious-oriented. You can always go to seculartherapy.org and find a damn good, well-trained therapist that will not send you back to church or tell you to pray hard.
Exactly. And you can also find Darryl at the Conference on Religious Trauma 2021. That's kind of happening in May. And listeners of this podcast can use the code POD, P-O-D-1-5, POD-15, to get a discount on getting in on the conference.
Excellent. Great.
Fantastic. Darryl, it's always a pleasure having you, my friend. But before I let you go, I got to have you say one more time, hi, this is Dr. Darryl Ray, and I took a left to the valley.
Hello, this is Dr. Darryl Ray, and I took a left at the valley, and then I masturbated after that.
Thank you for that. Thank you.
Fantastic, fantastic. Oh, my God. And that was Dr. Darryl Ray. He's always welcome on the show. I love Darryl Ray.
Yes, he was fun to have.
He's just an amazing guy. So much information in that little bit he just did there. It's amazing that how you find that, you know, QAnon and incel and all that, and it's just, they're just, Christians are relentless when it comes to sexuality. They're just obsessed with it. They
we
just
could probably
don't
do a two-hour show on that.
Yeah, I love it.
That's what I like about Darryl Ray is, he, like, because I grew up so fundamentalist, so much of what he talks speaks directly to me.
I bet.
The sexual purity, the purity culture, the fear of failure and all of that. It's just, it's mine. Yeah.
He's a wealth of information, and I'm so glad that we have the high priest of the Church of the Flying Spaghetti Monster on our side. He actually is that.
He's
officially
good.
Wonderful.
That shit is
traumatizing. I'm a member now. Haven't been before, but I'm joining today.
Yeah, that shit is traumatizing. Brent is right, and you know, it's not just traumatizing for the individual, but we pay as a society for this, and I think it's something that we need to really, really consider. Well, thank you so much for being on the show, guys, and thank you to our friend Darryl for being with us out today. Darryl, we hope to see you again, my friend. That'd be great.
That's Darryl.
Thank you for inviting me.
Darryl with a Y in Saskatchewan, and also thanks for Sabrina and Brent Lee for being with us, and thanks for Dr. Darryl Ray for being on the show as well. So you can follow us at leftofthevalley.ca. I will open the website. It's still kind of, well, it's there anyway.
Under development.
Under development.
But functional.
You can find us on Facebook. You can find us on Twitter at LATV Podcast. You can send us an email at leftatvalley@outlook.com. Coming up next, what we got next?
You tell me.
We have Janice Selby, and we're talking about the Conference on Religious Trauma that we just talked about it today. We'll have Brad Dirks. He's the father of a transgender child. We never really hear about the parents and how they feel and how they have to cope through all this.
I can't wait.
And we'll have Neil, the 604 atheist, as well. So, fantastic stuff coming up down the pipe.
Yes.
As per usual. Anything else we need to know? Darryl, before we let you go, buddy, anything you need to say? Hi, Mom.
Not at the moment.
Where can people find you?
Like, where can they look you up?
Find me on Facebook.
There we go. Find Darryl on Facebook.
Actually, I should say on, what's my Twitter? Darryl_Brad on Twitter.
There we go.
Awesome.
Sounds good.
Darryl with a Y.
That's right, Darryl with a Y.
And of course, you can also follow us on patreon.com/LETV, and you can become a part of the show, and you can help us, like the Right to Reason podcast, and I forget the name again.
It's
like,
right,
I think it's
down.
Like Patreon Sucks Balls or something like that.
That's probably why you're not saying it out loud.
Thank you so much, guys. Until next time.
Have a great week.
Bye.
And of course, we're doing the virtual Zoom orgy as usual.
All right, very good. I gotta take my clothes off for that.
What do you mean? You got clothes on? This is like the first time.
I mean, you're never supposed to wear clothes when you record with the show. I mean,
well, Darryl knows. He's been on the show.
He's
been on the show many times.
I'm sorry, I violated the rules. I don't usually. I'd usually am naked, as Kevin knows. Hands are bloodstained, millions of murders by believers.
me take a sec. Don't mean to sound so hateful, but I swear to God, unintended, I find it disgraceful that many atheists are told to be quiet. You're not alone, speak your mind, time to let it be known. I'm proud to be an atheist, a skeptic, a non-believer.